Good day, everyone, and welcome to the India Energy Forum by CERAWeek panel on technologies to optimize cost, recovery, and emissions in the upstream. My name is Judson Jacobs. I lead our oil and gas technology practice here at IHS Market, and I'll be the moderator for today's session. So we organized this panel with the recognition that the oil and gas sector is at a critical junction. Under pressure to reduce costs and increase efficiencies to remain competitive in an evolving energy landscape, the industry is also coming under increasing scrutiny around the greenhouse gas emissions associated with not only its products, but also its operations as well. The main recipe that worked during the last term, last downturn, turning to the supplier sector for price concessions, likely won't play this time around with an already stressed group. Instead, the industry must fundamentally rethink how it develops and operates its oil and gas resources if it wants to address these challenges. And we see technology and broader forms of Asian to be very much at the heart of these efforts. So we're very interested in learning more about such industry-leading efforts underway both here in India, as well as across the globe.
Okay.
And I can't think of a better panel for us to have brought together to explore such issues. And I'm honored to be joined on this, what's a virtual stage, by an incredibly distinguished group. Mr. Shashi Shankar, Chairman and Managing Director of the Oil and Natural Gas Corporation, Mr. Sunil Duggal, Group Chief Executive Officer for Vedanta, and Mr. Lorenzo Simonelli, Chairman and Chief Executive Officer of Baker Hughes. Welcome, gentlemen.
Thank you.
So let me kick things off with Mr. Shankar. We want to jump right into it. We don't have too much time together. What I wanted to do is just kind of get a sense of, offer your view of the conditions on the ground. What type of, how is your oil and gas portfolio feeling in terms of cost pressures, in terms of operating constraints that are being imposed by the pandemic? And are you beginning to see some of the, applications and implications and impacts of the application of technology and some broader forms of innovation as well?
Yeah, thank you, Jackson. In fact, this 2020 has not been a so good year for oil companies, be it upstream, refinery, petrochemicals. These have all been under stress. The year started with a price war. The price came down to all-time low. There was surplus inventory. In fact, WTI was sold. I mean, that was symbolic only, but it was negative dollars. Thereafter, this pandemic is struck. So what has happened, all those two factors have kept a lot of stress on oil and gas companies. As such, energy transition was taking place, but what this pandemic has done, it has fasten the pace of transition, I can say in a way. Now going forward, what we realize, this is going to be a new normal. Probably we are not going to see the price we had seen prior to 2014, like $100+ a barrel. Now the prices are going to remain in this range. So we got to learn to survive, operate in this low price scenario. Apart from this, because of the pandemic, there is a lot of constraints on operations. In our country, there are countrywide lockdown was there. And under those kind of conditions, people were confined to their homes. We had to learn a new way of working from home. The people out there in the field, they were confined to the platforms, to the respective installations. They were stuck for more than 2 months at one place. And in such time, maintaining all protocols of physical distancing, taking all due care so that people don't get infected. This had been a very, very challenging time for us. But now we have learned. I mean, we have been able to very successfully navigate through this trying time. So I can say, as a company, we realize that this pandemic, though this was taken for surprise to all of us, but there has been a new learning. there has been some very good opportunities also which has come on our way. We probably did not realize that there could be a seamless operation by people working at home, and that you could see that without, I mean, at full efficiency, people have worked from home. Our people out there in the field also, we have been able to work under the given situation. Our satisfaction. So, I mean, this has taught many things. So the details probably, if you would like to know what all we have done. In fact, the last quarter our realization was less than close to $25 per barrel. And in that kind of price scenario also, we have been able to make some kind of profit. So we adopted many things, many new things in our working. And probably this is what going further, probably we are going to further work on this and bring about use of new technology, by partnering with our vendors, by improving our efficiency. So we should be able to cope up with this situation.
Yeah, and that's a great, you know, kind of laying out some of the challenges and I guess this new normal that you talked about. Not only, you know, for folks who are sitting in the office environment, but obviously for operations as well. You know, not only coming under stress from market conditions, but Mr. Duggal, you know, so Vedanta is certainly known as a technology forward organization. You have many, you know, great innovations that are taking place. When things hit over the last, you know, 6 to 9 months, you know, did you have technologies in place that you are using, and you know, have those proved to be useful under current conditions? And do you see any type of acceleration or any type of new directions that you might be going with those as well?
So thank you, Jetson. As my friend said, that we have passed through a very, very difficult time of pandemic. But I would say that we have faced this situation very bravely. And the situation has become a new normal. We were trying to run certain digital initiative and technology initiative in our operation. But I think the new normal situation is where we have to embrace the technology, do the benchmarking, work out with the partners globally, like Baker Hughes and others, to bring in the technology digitization into our operation. But we have also found that there is a huge opportunity for us to work with the startups. And we are setting up a ecosystem of the startups. So globally, we are partnering and shortlisting some of the startup companies with whom we will work with. But just to let you know that what are the areas we are looking at the digitization and the technology usage, there are 5-6 fields on which we are trying to work. First is on the exploration and the new field development. We were working where the seismic data acquisition and the manual interpretation and then the field development plan. So we have partnered with some companies globally in which we have decided that capturing of the seismic data online and the processing of the data on the cloud and do the automatic interpretation of the data and then the field development planning. So what it will do, this is what we have done, and we have also done some proof of concept to find out what could be the utility of this. So what we have seen is the time to first oil could be reduced and the accuracy of interpretation of data and the success rate could be very high. So as you all know that oil and gas is a very capital intensive industry. If the success could be increased and the exploration cost could be reduced and the time to first oil could be shortened, this is the way to go. The other area which we are working is the decline and the reservoir management. In our operation, we are using the water and the columnar flooding. We have to go for the ESP technology going forward. Our R&R has to go up and our recovery has to go up. But in this area, in the existing fields, we have partnered with some of the startup companies where they have been able to use the data to optimize our water injection and polymer injection to cost the control, but also to optimize this injection in a way that the efficiency of the wells go up, by way of which the overall recovery is optimized. And we are also working on whether there are different options on the polymer where the polymer flooding could be changed from one type of polymer to the another, where the recovery can go up. And then a couple of other areas where we are working is the surface and subsurface operations, where the workover rig schedule could be optimized, in which, you know, if we have the opportunity of few wells which can come up, and using the data that which is the more efficient well, where the overall recovery and the overall volume can go up, and based on our overall work schedule, depending on the distance, resources, spare part requirement, how the overall management of the workover program can be managed. And then the next area we are trying to work on is the asset integrity, where the asset health, equipment health could be monitored, the predictive could be done, and the overall operating efficiency can go up. And also monitoring the artificial lift surveillance, the operation of the pumps, the efficiency of the pumps, and based on which the program could be worked out that what are the wells to work over, where the optimization, the overall optimization could be done, and we can work on the wells or the pumps which are not efficient. And then finally, on the HSE area, where the remote workover worker monitoring using the smart wearable, intelligent work to permit, video analytics, virtual reality based safety training, electronic barrier using image barrier, and geofencing. So these are some of the area in digital and technology we have seen in this pandemic that we are going to prioritize going forward, so that the overall efficiency of our resources, recovery of the resources could go up, the volume could be optimized, and the cost could also be controlled.
So no shortage of solutions. That's quite a few. You know, one of the things that I do want to come back to, you know, both you and as well as Mr. Shankar mentioned around kind of collaborating with folks outside of maybe the industry, and you both mentioned startups, which I'm really interested in. And especially your comment on working with them in the subsurface, which has typically been an area of competitive advantage. I find that very interesting, but we'll follow up on that later in the session as well. But I did want to turn to Mr. Simonelli now as well. You know, Baker Hughes obviously has the pleasure of serving customers all over the world. So you have a global perspective, and I'm really curious to understand, you know, where do you see demand? You know, where are companies coming to you, as well as how are you organizing yourself? Are you, if you are, serving your customers differently over the last 6 to 9 months?
Judson, great to be with you and also with my colleagues here on this interesting panel. And congratulations to IHS, really, for being able to have a virtual event of India Energy Forum. You know, the last few months and the last 9 months have been challenging, I think, for all of us. I think the aspect of technology, though, has been a bright spot. And what you've seen is really the resilience of both the operators as well as the service companies in being able to find ways in which you can utilize technology to conduct business. We know that energy is vital even during a pandemic. And we've seen an increasing use of remote drilling. In fact, many of our wells are now actually drilled remotely, which leads to a demanning at the site and enables people to be safe within their homes as the drilling takes place. But beyond that, also, as you look at other completions and you look at what was mentioned already on the remote monitoring of equipment that's out at site, we've seen an increasing use of remote monitoring, diagnostics, and the ability to preempt a field visit to actually anticipate a failure that's taking place. Now, all of this technology has been around, but I think what's different during the pandemic is that it's forced the collaboration between operators and also service companies and providers to work closely together and actually bring it to life. And I think that's something that's going to continue. We're going to see an acceleration of the remote capabilities and really utilization of digital collaboration. Additionally, I'd say in particular for India, there's an opportunity to continue the brownfield opportunity of existing wells and increasing production. As my colleague mentioned, the opportunity to look at the reservoir characterization, to be able to enhance the production through data analytics, that's something that we see, and also the uptime that we're able to achieve. So you can actually lower the CapEx and really enable production to be enhanced. So, you know, if there's a silver lining to the pandemic, it's that it's forced the industry to be continuously creative, collaborate together, and really drive the digital opportunities of capabilities to do things without people in the field.
Yeah, so it's kind of, you know, I know that these things have been around, you know, remote operations. We've been working on these for the last couple of decades, and it's really interesting to watch this kind of never let a crisis go to waste where we're forced to. It's not a nice to have, but it's really, you know, kind of this is the way that we need to work kind of going forward. You know, one of the things that all three of you brought up is, you know, I think working with new technologies, and I think digitalization is a theme that has, you know, kind of is playing out very well. I think a lot of the investments that companies have made over the last 4 or 5 years have actually put us in a pretty good position to, better position we are today than we would have been maybe 4 or 5 years ago. But let me pick up on that. You know, as we begin to, you know, kind of go into some of these new spaces around digitalization, the idea around collaboration, the idea, you know, kind of how do you both collaborate externally as well as collaborate internally? Mr. Shankar, I'll turn back to you again, because you brought up kind of working with startups and just kind of along that theme around digitalization or around kind of new technologies, how are you engaging with new types of companies that maybe you didn't interact with so much kind of prior?
Okay. Now, before I come to that, just to add to what Mr. Loringer said, that it's now become a necessity. Business partnership has become a necessity, not only for the operator, but for the service provider as well. So now you see the more and more kind of engagement between operators and service providers. For example, again, we have a one deep water project which is under implementation in the East Coast. And Loringer is a partner there. So there what we have done, in fact, the way that contract has been structured is G and McDermott, they have joined hands together. So one is you're going to provide you the equipment, the service, SPS package, and the other is going to execute the project. So our exposure reduces, and for them also, I mean, this time, I mean, gone are the days when, as I said earlier, that we are going to see a price in excess of $100 a barrel. So on this price, both of us have to survive. So probably the business partnership is very, very critical. We need to collaborate with each other. Coming to your digital initiatives, at the company level, in fact, we have long time back to 2014 only we realized probably we need to bring in more of efficiency in our operations, decision-making process. So what we had done, we are probably one of the very few companies in India, we had gone paperless. So we have a paperless project called Disha. So all the transactions are taking place in a paperless mode. We have an ERP platform which is based on SAP. Now we are going to upgrade to HANA. So during this pandemic period, our entire business transaction has taken place without any interruption. It was a very smooth interruption. Coming to efficiency improvement, the data analytics is going to play a very important role. On all our rigs, we have gone in for data analytics. There are some hidden lost time. So if you compare one rig for another rig, a simple operation, if you see making up a pipe joint, that also, if you analyze on different rigs, though apparently it looks like people have been working all throughout, but if you critically analyze it, there is a big difference between that. So we are trying to optimize that. So big data analytics is going to help you in a big way. Now, all this greenfield development, which is going to be undertaken, for that matter, even our deep water project, we are going to have a completion where all the gadgets will be sitting down the hole, the real-time, the reservoir monitoring will take place. So as and when needed, you can take corrective measures so that the reservoir health is maintained, you can have a higher recovery factor. Then coming to your startup, in fact, we have, in a small way, we have created a fund for startup, and we are trying to encourage startups to get into energy space. There is quite a good number of startups which have come forward, and some of them have picked up projects on digitalization. One project is working with us on artificial intelligence. We see one area, especially the exploration, there is a huge data which is lying with us. Probably that data, if you can properly make use of it, it will help you in a big way in prospect generations. That will improve your success rate. Again, coming to it, now we are changing all our fleet. I mean, the drilling fleets. We have gone in for, there are 50 plus new generation rigs are coming to us. These are all automated. People have been talking about rig of the future. People are talking about that we got to go in a factory mode drilling, like we have been doing for CBM wells, the shell oil wells. So similarly, the conventional oil wells can be also done in a factory mode by integrating your offshore well data, whatever data you have, that can be integrated with your electronic gadgets of your new generation rig. So that will help you in reducing your downtime, having less complications, better completion of wells. On the carbon emission front also, there are some companies that have been working on it. From the emission from a diesel engine, they are going to make a kind of thing. So there are a number of companies, we are supporting them for a startup, and as and when it comes to a stage, we'll further help them out and provide them some kind of job opportunities so that they do still better.
Yeah, and it's great to see these more open forms of innovation. I think, you know, everyone's been talking, and you know, the three of you have been talking about engagement outside of your companies, which is a great trend to see. And I think, you know, especially as we move into this brave new world of digitalization, kind of low carbon, is that, you know, I think there's an increasing recognition that companies can't do it. Mr. Duggal, you know, one of the things, you know, collaboration outside, but, you know, you have the advantage as well as having a number of different verticals within Vedanta. And, you know, I'm curious to understand just within, you know, what might be separate operating units, you know, does that collaboration happen as well? And do you see these kind of great ideas percolating up in different parts of the business? And how do you then be able to share those and make sure you have best practices in, you know, maybe some kind of cross-cutting areas? Is that taking place within your company?
Yes. I mean, that's something probably we have very proactively, we have taken this initiative. We have come out with a shared services center. In fact, we are going to set up. This experience of pandemic has taught us many good things also. We found that people have been working from home, and there has been a seamless operation that they're providing services to different assets. As you know, that our operations are spread all across the country, onshore, offshore. So what we have decided, that we'll have a shared services center. All the support services will be housed at one place. And from that center only, they'll be providing services to all the different producing assets that they are, different exploratory basins are there. So they'll be providing those services from there. The advantage of this shared services center will be, one, there will be a drastic reduction in cost of your manpower. Secondly, there will be standardization of process services. So all across the organization, there will be a standardization will take place. It will cut down your cost also. Again, next step, what you're going to do it, we have a number of resources in terms of drilling rigs, workover rigs, we have stimulation vessels. So we'll make one center, centralized, similar to their support services. Once centrally there, from there, all these resources will be located there, and they can optimally distribute the resources as and when, wherever it is required. So that will be a better utilization of resources. So these are some of the
What's interesting is that sounds very similar to, you know, it's almost the Baker Hughes model, where, you know, kind of serving many from a centralized location. Is that it's interesting to see that taking place within an oil company as well. And Mr. Duggal as well, within Vedanta, you know, are you seeing, you obviously have a number of different verticals, not only oil and gas, but you also have mining and minerals as well. Do you see the opportunity, whether on an operational basis, in some of the things that Mr. Shankar was talking about, but do you as well, kind of just sharing best practices and sharing, you know, some of your kind of learnings across them in different areas? Do you see that taking place, and are the things that you're doing to try to encourage that as well?
Thanks, Jetson. My friend Shashi Shankar said that we are more like a global village now, and there is an increased opportunity for us to work in a more collaborative manner, where the people like Baker Hughes, Halliburton, and others, they may not have enough work, but they are a digital company and they can help us to improve our operation. But if we also look at within Vedanta, I think as far as the Vedanta is concerned, I think we are one of the most versatile companies, where our product portfolio is very versatile, like BHP Billiton, but we are into oil and gas, we are into mining, we are into smelting, we are into power generation. But there are a lot of opportunities which we have been running in our organization. But this pandemic taught us much more than what we could have done. So some of the common themes which we run across the organization, one is the Vedanta Sustainability Assurance Program. So this program helps us to drive common sustainability and safety practices across the group. This also includes various processes like process safety, incident investigation, contractor management, improving technology deployment across various processes. The second area which we work as a common theme is the asset optimization, common framework across the group. That helps us also to drive the common practices across the organization. Then we have an audit framework across the organization, which helps us to ensure consistency, standardization, ensure all businesses are in similar maturity across different process areas and technology adoption. These audit areas include safety, sustainability practice, asset optimization, logistic automation, people, HR practice, cyber security, and areas like that. Now, of late, we have started developing a group-wide organization where the themes like AO, safety, digitization, HR practices, cyber security, the management assurance program, these programs are being run. Now, we have created a group-wide digitization design. This is going to help us a clear roadmap of initiative, and will also help us to copy-paste the best technology to different businesses, benchmark with the best in the world, drive change management, and ensure that we realize the real benefit for which we design our systems and processes. So these are some of the common practices we are trying to run across all Vedanta entities.
It's really great to see, and I'm sure that there's really a lot of opportunities that the great ideas that are taking place in one part of the business, there are some commonalities and parallels, and there's some new ideas that can kind of come up. One of the themes, I mentioned at the beginning, but then I think we've kind of been touching upon it as well, but the idea around sustainability and emissions as well. And Mr. Simonelli, I'd really appreciate getting your perspective here, because I know that having some of your recent announcements, I think Baker Hughes positioning itself as not just an oil field services company, but as an energy services company. And the idea that we have as well, that there's not it's a false choice between energy efficiency and emissions reduction, as well as cost reduction as well. And so in many cases, those two things are parallel. So very curious to see, what's taking place within Baker Hughes, and what new areas in which you might be heading as well.
Yes, and I think some of the points have already been touched. But if you look at the challenge we face, and I think it's ever present in India as well, is people are demanding more energy, and they're also demanding more from energy. Clean, sustainable, affordable, reliable, and also that we acknowledge that there is a climate change and a carbon dioxide issue that we need to confront. So if you look at the opportunities we have, natural gas and LNG is a clear growth driver. If you look at the opportunity of hydrogen as we go through the energy transition, as you look at carbon capture under sequestration, at Baker Hughes, we do call ourselves an energy technology company, and we made a commitment at the beginning of 2019 that we would reduce our carbon emissions by 50% by 2030, and be net zero by 2050. As you've seen, a number of different companies are approaching a similar type of commitment, as well as nation states. And when you look at the demand growth that's going to happen in India, and you heard it yesterday from Prime Minister Modi with respect to, there's going to be, during the course of next years, basically an increase in population the same size as the United States, over 325 million people. They're going to be demanding energy. And we collectively, together as a group, are both the operators as well as ourselves as furnishing technology, need to be ready and able through digital collaboration, through technologies and new equipment that can be upgraded, which is more efficient, through the ability to run on hydrogen, which we have turbines and compressors today that can already be with hydrogen, as well as carbon capture and sequestration. And really, it's an energy mix that's going to evolve, and we have to be there and actually be the forcing drive forward, because just renewables by itself is not the answer. It is a complete aspect of the oil and gas industry in combination with the new energy frontiers that will provide what's required going forward.
That's great. And it's a very strong statement around, you know, kind of, you know, where the industry is and, you know, its opportunity as well. And, you know, maybe just picking up on that, Mr. Shankar, you know, for ONGC, what does this mean in terms of the greenhouse gas emissions, in terms of sustainability? How is this playing out within your company?
Yeah. So as a responsible corporate, we are aware of our ESG obligations and we make all efforts to comply with it. We'll be happy to know that way back in the year 2005, we have created a separate group called CMSG, Corporate Carbon Management and Sustainability Group. There we regularly map our carbon emission footprint. We'll be happy that during the last couple of years, our carbon footprint has reduced by 6%. It's from 0.0332 trillion ton carbon dioxide emission per barrel to 0.031 ton CO2 emission per barrel. And for this, we have taken a number of initiatives. In fact, we are the first company. We have implemented a number of CDM projects. One of the largest CDM projects is a gas-based power plant. There we, by now, we have earned more than 2 million CERs to our credit. The building in which I'm sitting, this is a green building. This is a platinum rated green building. We have, of this type, we have two more buildings, one in Mumbai, the other one is in at our headquarter, Dehradun. Then all our lighting, light fittings, we have converted into LED fittings. That also has reduced a lot of energy and our carbon emission. As a chairman of ONGC, I'm also the chairman of United Compact Network of India, which is the United Nations Global Compact Network. And there are a number of member corporates, I mean, they include your public sector, private sector. And through this, we are driving a lot of SDG the goals, not only within the company, across the country, we are doing it. As Lauren just said, the new equipment, now all the new equipment, now the engines, what we have procured now.
And we're getting the hook, we're getting the sign that our time is coming to an end. But that is, I think what, you know, all of the comments that you had there were that, you know, we could talk about, you know, what's being done around kind of energy transition, around energy efficiency for a long time to come. I think we can make that a separate, you know, kind of session. But there are a few things, you know, just kind of closing it out, you know, a few things really stood out to me in today's session is that one, I think, you know, all of you kind of said that the conditions are being put in place now that really to kind of drive technology adoption, that the challenges that are related to the, you know, both the current market conditions as well as the pandemic are actually, you know, serving as an impetus to adopt some of those technologies and practices that maybe weren't there before. I really was heartened to see collaboration in many of its different forms, both traditionally between the oil companies and the oil field services sector, but also the number of mentions of startups and more open forms of innovation, and even breaking down barriers within companies as well. You know, maybe some of the different business lines that previously worked separately, that there are opportunities to kind of learn from one another. And then finally, I mean, I think the positive role that the energy companies now and the energy technology companies can play in reducing not only the emissions of the industry, but also kind of the global emissions as well. I think it's a positive way to kind of close this out. So really appreciate all of your comments and all of your thoughtful perspectives on these many different themes. And I want to, you know, once again, thank you for joining us at the, you know, the India Energy Forum in this session. And thank you again to our panelists.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.